take it and find a way to write it and to build off of it. So it starts out as that inner thought. And, you know, developmental psychologists have been debating for some time about whether there is an inner language and whether or not that is something innate. And what you actually learn later on is your secondary language that's communicative, such as English or Mandarin. And it essentially becomes a vehicle through which you codify your thoughts and can communicate them and work with them. For different languages, there's debate on whether or not you have a difference in thought and cognitive differences between languages. It's heavily debated, but for example, in Eastern Asian languages, in many of them, they don't have verb tense. So you won't have a past tense or a future tense, you'll just have the present, I go. And it is a parallel to their society in which they're very present, they live in the present. And this is a very vague difference to our own culture. We are very, very future oriented. And this sort of difference is also can be seen in music. So in Western music, we're very time focused. We constantly are beating time, we're reading very linearly. But if you were to play a traditional shakuhachi piece, you will find that it's actually very cyclical. If you think about it within the breath, it's not focused on linear time as we understand it. So, as compared to music, well, I wanted to find a notation that would inform these inner thoughts, find a new way to think about how I'm thinking. So, in writing this, I needed to find a way to write music using my head that would best suit the music. So I started out with just the standard notation, very linear, and what you typically see when you get a piece of music. So I brought it in to my lesson, and we took a look at it, and we're like, actually, it's going to be a minimalist piece. And I was directed to look at a score of Gutostavsky and look at one of his concertos. And I rewrote the piece in this new notation that actually focused on cycles of music. And instead of each bar is a certain number of beats and it continues on linearly, we would have this sort of cycle in time. We would just sit and play it over and over again. And the idea was that these cycles would go on a certain period of time. Now, this was obviously a major reconceptualization of how I thought about the piece and how I organized it. And it gave it a lot of freedom. It gave it sort of the mobility to exist instead of have to be, when it's all written out, I can think this is the same thing over and over again, but the cycle is how it's designed to be. And I think the only drawback to it was that it didn't actually have the freedom that I wanted my players to have. So for that sort of cycle, it was the same thing written out for them already. There was no choice. So, what I actually ended up doing is taking it back to my lesson and was directed to Steve Reich's Music for 18 Musicians. And there was a new notation that involved repetitions. And essentially, what would happen is that I would indicate a certain number of repetitions for a cycle to go on. And it had cues so that players would know when to move on to the next section. And more importantly, it had these floating bars. And with the floating bars, instead of having one figure that they play over and over again. So it gave this freedom of choice. And it also allowed for better transitions, because I actually wanted to include some linear sections in the music, sort of more traditional, but the Lutoslavsky style would have been very difficult for us to orient ourselves in the play and to move on to the next section. So with this style, we would have the cues and we would be able to